programming of WSKB is provided by Westfield Bank. For more than 160 years, Westfield Bank has been an important community presence and commercial leader in the Pioneer Valley. With convenient full banking services in Westfield, West Springfield, East Longmeadow, Agawam, Feeding Hills, Springfield, Southwick, as well as Enfield and Granby, Connecticut, visit us on the web at westfieldbank.org.
I'm Mark Auerbach. Join me every Friday at 8 a.m. for Arts Beat, where you'll meet interesting actors, directors, designers, and musicians here in Western New England.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
We'll be right back.
And good morning. Welcome to Superintendent Spotlight. And this is our second show of the year. So it's good to be back. Pete, thanks again.
Having you here.
Yeah.
Getting the information out.
It is. In the middle of our screen, you'll see that Melanie Chassie is here. She's the principal of Paper Mill Elementary School. Good morning, Melanie. How are you today? Can she talk, Pete?
She's got to unmute.
Wonderful.
There
good
you
to
go.
See you guys.
I can hardly hear her.
Hold on.
Yeah,
I got to
hear Melanie.
Hold on. There you go. Try it now.
Say hi again.
Wonderful. How are you?
Oh, that's perfect.
See, I had SpaceX commentary. It was the same feed path, so I had to turn it back up for you guys.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. Sorry.
That's all right. And so, that's one of the things, Melanie, on the way in, I was listening to 89.5, and there was a rocket launch. So we have to top a rocket launch. What do you have?
No, I don't top rocket launches.
No, I don't know that we can. And so you'll notice that Chris Rogers is not here with me today. Instead, we have a guest host, Susan Dargy. Welcome, Susan.
Thank you very much. I'm happy to be here.
And you'll be our guest next week, right?
Yes.
So today you're guest hosting, and next week you're our guest. So that's perfect. Before we get started, I just want to remind families that grab-and-go meals for students are still available through this Friday, September 11th at Westfield Middle School and Abner Gibbs Elementary School from 11 to 1. Every child will still be provided a free grab-and-go meal. No ID is required. It is a first-come, first-serve basis. And Susan, what do you have? Something too, I think, right?
I do. We have Google training going on all week with all of our staff. And as part of that training, we are offering parent Google tutorials. Google is the platform, the technology platform that we use in Westfield and that we will be using for our remote learning. And the two features that we want to make sure that parents are aware of and understand are Google Classroom, which is the virtual space that teachers create and invite students into and post all of their assignments and videos and communicate with students, and Google Meet, which is the live video meeting tool that allows students to be with their teachers
and their peers.
And their peers.
Exactly.
And
great.
We have four sessions offered: September 9th at 7 p.m., September 10th at 1 p.m., September 10th at 7 p.m., and September 11th at 9 a.m. And those are open to all Westfield Public School parents. It is a virtual training, so it can be done anywhere that you are with internet. And you will access those trainings by clicking on the link. The link has been posted on our district Facebook.
Yeah, it's right in the front page. So you just go and click on the bottom. And then you'll notice when you put your mouse over or whatever you're using, over the date, you just click on it and you can go in. And it's $250 per session, correct?
Right. The maximum number in a Google Meet is $250. So if you don't get into a certain session, there are three others to choose from. And we are setting up additional sessions for October, November, and December. And if you do have any questions about how to access these sessions, you can call the curriculum office at 562-2298, and we will help you.
Wow. Nice job, Susan. Thank you.
Thank you.
And just really quick before we get to our guest, and today we're going to talk, we have two topics. We're talking with Melanie about social-emotional learning, and there's been a lot of questions about that and what we're going to do with that. And then in the second half hour, we have Rachel Kenya, who is the Director of Food Services, because there are certainly questions about that as well. So we'll have some information about that. But I just want to point out to parents, so principals will be doing calls some have already done it, to families this week to kind of update them on where we are at. Schedules should be out next week, and we are also distributing Chromebooks next week. So, and we are, of course, the first day of school, September 14th. And so I just want to put that out there. So it's coming. We do know people are getting a little anxious, and so are we. But this has been probably the most difficult opening of a school year that I can remember in 26 years.
28 Melanie? Years for me, and I would agree.
Melanie, would you agree with that?
I'm right behind you guys, right in the middle there. I've been, this is year 27, I think, and we've never experienced this.
This is crazy. And we are trying, listen, there are going to be some hiccups, folks. We've never done this before. And here's someone that's hoping that we never have to do this again, actually, too. I'm hoping by next year we're back to normal, but it is where it is. So, Melanie, well, so I'm going to ask you to give a little definition, because when we hear the term SEL, right, so that's social emotional learning, and I'm giving the acronyms because that's what we do here on our show for people, because we get caught up in our own educational jargon. When we think about social emotional learning, what does that actually mean, Melanie? Do you mind giving us a little background?
It's basically, in a nutshell, it's a commitment to students' mental health.
Right.
And it's some students require more support than others. We all know that. And it's basically just saying, you know, we're committed to not only the physical well-being, but the emotional well-being of our students.
Right.
And we think of our students in terms of levels of support. And then we start to develop systems for the different levels. So for instance, as we look at 100% of our students, what are we gonna do for 100% of our students? And then if that doesn't help the students be as healthy as we want them to be, and they tell us either through their words or their behavior that they need more, then we get them into a smaller group. And we start to look at different tools. We start to use our school adjustment counselors. We increase communication with families, and we start looking at a different type of resource. And then again, if that doesn't work, then we start thinking of our students as just one-on-one, and we look at our family systems. And here in Westfield, we really have a lot of support for students in those three areas.
I think we do. And I want to shout both of you out, because I know, so, you know, I think folks know that we've had many subcommittees working on our opening of school. And Melanie, you chaired the SEL subcommittee, and Susan was a member of that committee. So I think both of you really can talk to this, right? I
mean, right. And we appreciate that you recognizing the importance of the social emotional curriculum, and student behaviors, and how much we need to focus on that. We did separate that out from curriculum and instruction committee, but we did work together to have a cohesive plan, as we do in regular times.
Right.
It all fits together for the whole child, for the benefit.
Well, and I think too, child. One of the pieces why the emphasis on SEL is always there, but why we want to talk about it even more this year, is because we haven't had our students in school since March. I think there's that whole transition piece, and we're starting remote and gradually going through a hybrid, but we still need to offer that social emotional support for some of our students. And, you know, a lot of our students, you know, they miss school, and we miss them. I mean, just the same. So I think, you know, trying to meet, you know, it's interesting, because when I worked here as a principal, we had a school adjustment counselor at the time, and something he said to me always clicked, which was, you know, the students have to be ready to learn. And if they can't, because they're social emotional, they're not ready to do that, we have to get them there. And so we have many mechanisms in place to try and do that. And so maybe we can walk through a little bit of some of those steps. But I do, you know, so we hear the term school adjustment counselor. Mm-hmm. All right. You know, most families are familiar, because when I was a student, I don't think I had that in school. I don't know if you remember. I don't remember there was a school adjustment counselor.
No, I think people are more familiar with
guidance
counselors, which are our guidance counselors in Westfield. Begin working with students at the seventh grade level. And I think there is so much more overlap now,
right,
between the work of the two groups, because we don't really separate out your college and career aspirations from your day-to-day connections and social emotional health.
Right.
So our guidance counselors are also really supporting the social emotional development as much as our school adjustment counselors. And school adjustment counselors we have all the way from pre-K to 12.
We have at least one in every school.
Yes.
which is good. And so for someone who may not know, then what is a school adjustment counselor?
Melanie, do you want it?
Well, I, you know, coming from Maine, We actually don't have that label of school adjustment counselor. We would call them our social workers.
Okay.
And that's what they are.
Right.
Yeah. Yes. And, right. So like, for instance, for us, we have our school adjustment counselors focus on friendship skills, how to make a friend, how to keep a friend, how to share, some of those basic things that sometimes are learned at home and can be seen at home. But then when they come to our environment, especially at the elementary level, it's hard to do that, especially when it's new toys, new materials, new people. And instead of making an assumption that the skill's there, we teach the skill.
It can be overwhelming for a student, right? Don't you think?
Oh, my goodness, yes. I mean, say, for instance, you're six, which means you're at the end of kindergarten, maybe, or the beginning of first grade, and you are in a completely new environment. You don't have your siblings. You don't have your parents. And you're just like, what do you do? And some kids naturally handle that well and can take deep breaths and say, you know what, I don't need to have that object, game, toy, pencil right now. And others can't. They're like, no, I want it now.
Right.
And now you're in a community. Now you're in a family outside of your original family. And how do you survive? How do you cope and how do you thrive? Because we don't want our kids in survival mode. We want them thriving.
Right. And our teachers certainly work on these skills as well. But they have so much to focus on with the academic that it's wonderful to have the school adjustment counselors whose focus is all about the development of this domain. And earlier you mentioned the 100% of student, that tiered system of support. So the school adjustment counselors can work with 100% of our students. All of the kids in the school know who these adults are and that they are there to help them if they need help, and also to teach everyone those lessons that you're talking about. So could you talk a little bit about what about those next tiers and how do adjustment counselors help with students who need more support?
Sure. It looks a little bit different, I think, depending on the level that you're at, obviously. My experience is mostly that K through 6 realm. So I think when we find either through, wow, surprise, surprise, either we find through parent referral, teacher referral, student self-referral, if a student is just not being as successful as we want, to say, you know what, we're going to break this down into a smaller group, maybe 2 or 3, and we're going to practice those skills that we've been learning in the large group to take them to the small group. We also have different tools. And of course, the tool, you know, of course, when you're on the radio, your vocabulary falls out, and I can't think of zones of regulation. That's what I want to say. That is a practice that's been coming about probably, I'd say, within the last 5 years, where it teaches children to specifically identify their feelings. And as they're becoming, say, more calm, that's one thing, and it's self-rewarding. And as they're becoming more agitated, what do you do? Right. And again, we, instead of assuming a child can do that, we teach, because that's what we do. We're school.
Right.
And multiple domains, like you said, Susan.
Right. And at other grade levels, and as feelings and tasks increase in difficulty, we have adjustment counselors that are supporting a lot of those developmental pieces up to and including. Our counselors are dealing with things like substance abuse with our students that are at older adolescents. And also, I know that adjustment counselors may have groups that focus on grief, for example. Yeah. If there are a number of students that they know of that are experiencing something, they can sometimes build a support group with parents, you know, knowledge of that and help everyone work through those things as well.
Absolutely. Our counselors, our school adjustment and counselors and our counselors deal with things like grief, divorce, friendship making. It's it could be a new baby. That's a big change in a family. If you're a six-year-old and you've always been the only child and then boom, infant, that's a surprise.
Sure.
So our counselors will deal with just a multitude of things. One of the most important things I think our counselors do are friendship groups with new students that come to Westfield.
That's excellent.
That talk about nerve-wracking. It's, you know, as we look at all of our students right now coming back after 6 months of school, that's one type of newness. But being the new student that moves in the middle of the year, that's stressful. Yes. So our counselors do a great job with that. They'll often deal with students that have anxieties about performance, whether it be art, music, PE, mathematics, reading. So we really look at just who is the child and what do they need.
And I think, and it's so individualized too. I think that's what people have to understand. I mean, there are certainly, you can have a grief group, but with a lot of our students, some of their situations are unique. So, and I think our school adjustment counselors do an excellent job. Again, as I mentioned earlier, trying to get the students ready to learn. All right, Pete, I think we're going to take our first quick break. Melanie will be back in a few minutes. So stay on for us and we'll come back and talk about what are some of the more specific interventions that we have. Thanks for listening, folks.
Too much of this life to hang on. Support for Community Radio on WSKB is provided by Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue in Westfield.
Hi, it's Bob Plass, and I have Wow It's Tuesday every Tuesday, 6 to 8. Wow, it's Tuesday.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
I did it!
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
And welcome back to Superintendent Spotlight. So I picked... I mean, the song today, that was Everybody Hurts by R.E.M. I don't know if you were able to hear that, but it seemed appropriate. But I also, Susan and I were talking offline, and R.E.M. was my first concert that I ever went to in 1995. Susan, your first concert?
Was a little earlier. And it was REO Speedwagon and 38 Special, which Stefan had to remind me was 38 Special because I called them 48 Special.
All right, Melanie, what was your first concert?
Steve Miller Band.
Oh, wow. That must have been a good concert.
Classic.
It was.
Pete, your first concert, do you remember?
Aerosmith.
Aerosmith. That was my second, and that was a great concert, too.
Yep.
Yeah. All right, so we have a little bit of time left here with Melanie, and I wanted to get into first our partnerships, because we have a lot of great partnerships with others, and I know Susan has been working with that too, so either one of you can talk about, but I know specifically with BHN and River Valley Counseling, anyone want to talk about either one, or you want to do BHN, Melanie, and Susan can do River Valley?
That's a great, yeah, perfect. We certainly can do that. So both of those agencies we partner with to provide school-based outpatient services, and meaning that counselors are available in our schools. We give them a space to work in and meet with our students. And it's for families who might be working during the day or transportation is difficult for them to get to after-school appointments.
Right. Yeah.
So, you know, there's certainly a section of our population where and we're taking away barriers to their service. So, I know that there are a couple of elementary schools that have ongoing relationships with that BHN Carson Center, but I want to give Susan big kudos for getting the River Valley Counseling Center partnership set up recently.
Yeah, well, Stefan and I had been working on that for quite a while because you had originally brought them in on the ARC program, which is a substance abuse program that we connected them with. And then we've been working with Alexa Mignano, the director of school partnerships there, to bring them in to all of our schools eventually. And we will be starting with them this month, and it will be a telehealth partnership at first, but eventually they will be in our schools as our BHN counselors who are working with us come in, but they will be there for full days and up to full weeks. So they really become a part of the school community and get to know the families over years and through transitions. Yeah. So students that might be working with them at the intermediate school, Alexa is able to make adjustments in scheduling so that they may be able to continue with that counselor into their transition to middle school. So we are starting out with 4 schools for the partnership with a goal of bringing all the other schools on board. And this would be through insurance. Parents insurance is how these referrals are made. So the principals have, of these 4 schools to start, which are Franklin Avenue, Westfield Intermediate, Westfield Middle School, and Westfield High School. The principals and counselors have communicated to the families that this opportunity is available, and specifically to students that they know had been on waiting lists or have had difficulty with transportation getting to appointments that would have been at the site.
So excellent.
We are excited.
I think, you know, what we see is an increasing need for our students, which is why we're working with these outside organizations. And we also know, right, the wait lists are pretty rough. Some are months, right? Some of them are months out. And so we know our kids need services, so we're doing what we can to help facilitate that and move it along. Our last topic with Melanie, though, is going to be about PBIS. And I know that, Susan, you really kind of brought that and promoting that through the district years ago. And we are now embracing PBIS pretty much K to 12.
Yes, pre-K has
the pyramid model.
But it is all connected, and Melanie brings a wealth of experience in PBIS to the district. So I was so happy to have a partner in crime in terms of helping schools to solidify their implementation and increase. So Melanie, thank you. And can you give us an update on what you're working on now in terms of translating this into the remote environment?
Sure. What we're doing now is we're focusing on that 100% of students, but we had to reimagine our communication with parents and how we support them from the home, because we got some feedback, some great parent feedback in our surveys last spring that said, help me with what do I do with my student refuses? Help me with a schedule. Help me, you know, help us. And we understand that. And, you know, this is what we do. And we understand that it's very difficult as parents. So we've looked, most of our PBIS teams, which do exist at every school.
Yes.
Westfield Technical Academy is going now as the SEL committee. But they are coming from a database and a background of PBIS implementation. And that's another acronym, Positive Behavioral Interventions and Supports. It's been around for about 30 years, started in the Midwest and the West out of the University of Oregon. A couple of researchers that have background in behavioral health and also psychology, George Sugai, Rob Horner, and then it came over to University of Connecticut. So we have a really rich resource at UConn with Brandy Simonson, if it matters to anybody who's listening.
Well, we work with UMass too, right, Susan?
Yes.
We do. So, you know, PBIS is not new. Is it filtered from the central part of the country to the west and then to the east? And so a lot of people haven't heard of it, but it's a system, it's a framework.
Positive behavioral intervention support or system?
Supports.
Okay.
Yeah.
And gotta do the acronym again.
I know, that's why I said it. I know I try not to. So our teams are working on packets and toolkits for parents while kids are at home. Simple things like, how do I take care of my device? What are the expectations? how do I address the, how do I help my student with their pre-academic skills, meaning how do I get them up in the morning and get them on the computer for their first meeting, you know, their first Google Meet. And we've done some really great work. I want to give kudos to the PBIS coaches who have, with Susan, been committed here in Westfield for many years and keeping their teams on track. I think one of the things that we as, it's all connected, right? It's, you can't, it's layer after layer, and it's just, we're like this fine little French cake that it's just layer, 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 but all together we're more delicious. So, and I know we all like food, so why not?
Yeah, I haven't had breakfast. I'm starving.
Uh-oh. So I want to give them kudos for keeping that work going, because it's not easy to reimagine what we're going to do for kids, but we know how important it is. So a lot of toolkits for parents. The other things that we're doing are things like responsive classrooms morning meeting, or a variation thereof. So we've taken a framework for PBIS and we've used another evidence-based practice, which is an evidence-based practice, mm-hmm. and we've taken another evidence-based practice in responsive classrooms morning meeting, and that's really how you build community. And now we have to imagine it, because we, all of our adults, we know what it's like to sit on Zoom, and we know that it's not the same as being in person.
No, we miss you. You should be in the studio with us, you know? But I don't think we can.
An input, because there's not enough feet.
There's not enough feet.
There's not enough feet. So we have to support all of our learners to engage in this platform. Again, not easy, but we're going to give it our best shot.
We're
going to
get there. Okay. Yep. All right. We've got to thank you, Melanie, for joining us today. Pete, can you let Rachel in so we can say hi to her? Melanie. First of all, for your work on SEL for this year, I think parents are going to be happy to know that there is more information coming to them. And I think they got some good information about BHN and River Valley Counseling. So, again, thank you for that. And we know that all of our students will have access to school adjustment counselors. Is that about a good wrap up there?
That is. Okay. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you, Susan.
Thank you, Melanie.
See you later.
Thank you. All right.
Bye.
All right.
And if you look, Rachel's in. We just need to have Melanie jump out.
All right, Melanie, we need you to. There we go. Now we've got Rachel. Hi, Rachel.
How are you?
We're doing well. But listen, I wanted to welcome you. We're going to talk about food services in a minute, but we do have to take a quick commercial break, so we'll be back in a few. Thanks for joining us.
She rattled the ass in my plastic cup. I said, yes, ma'am, fill her up. Tell me something good that I don't know. Cause this world's been kicking my behind. Life ain't been a friend of mine. Lately, I've been feeling kind of low. And she looked back over her shoulder, pointed at the sign hanging up on the wall. Let's see, everything's gonna be alright. Everything's gonna be alright. Nobody's gotta worry about nothing. Don't go hitting that panic button. It ain't worth spilling your drink. Everything's gonna be
nodded my head and said that's for sure. Dropped a few butts in the mason jar. Felt those good old neon vibes on me. And whatever monkey that was on my back, he jumped off just like that, right into the deep blue sea. And I look back over her shoulder, thinking about the sun hanging up on the wall. Let's say everything's gonna be alright. Everything's gonna be alright. Nobody's gotta worry about nothing. Don't go hitting that panic button. It ain't near as bad as you think. Everything's gonna be alright. All right.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Listen to me, Michael Buster McMahon, Mondays 8 to 10 a.m. to learn the stories behind your favorite songs. Or don't. I'm not the boss of you.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB. Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 at 89.5 FM, WSKB Westfield.
And welcome back to Superintendent Spotlight. If you didn't notice, by the way, it's warm out already today. It's humid.
Yes.
It's sticky, and I think it's going to stay that way. I think we're looking at a high of 85 today or something around
there.
Yeah,
and then the humidity is going to break for tomorrow.
Perfect, perfect.
By the way, I was doing some teaching in the break.
You were?
Yes.
Who were you teaching?
I was teaching Rachel something.
How to do what?
She came in as vertical on her phone, so I taught her how to flip to horizontal for TV, and it looks so much better that way.
Nice. So you would have been like sideways otherwise?
No,
like,
no, up and down, but it looks more cropped.
Oh,
but
this,
it doesn't
okay.
fit right in the box.
Got it. Okay.
Different nice. Different dimensions.
Nice job, Pete.
But you know, we teach her on this is what we do.
Yes.
Nice.
That was we talked about that last segment too.
It's what we do.
So Rachel is the food services director for Westfield Public Schools, and she's done a phenomenal job. I just thank you for all your effort, Rachel. I know that the USDA threw a recent curve at you. You had plans all set up, and then they changed everything in the middle of the game. And that's really what our summer's been like, Susan.
Yes,
would you agree?
That is.
Yeah. We get a piece of guidance or it's saying this is a mandate, and then it changes a week later after you make all the plans. That seems to be the way things go around this time of year. And that's why I can't reiterate enough that we appreciate everyone's patience. We certainly aren't dragging our feet. We sleep very little. we are on Zoom meetings far too often, but it's the way we have to meet right now. And Rachel joins us on those. She's on our e-board, our reopening e-board. And obviously food services has a lot to do with that. So
we need to eat.
And I know that you're wrapping up the summer program. I started the show, Rachel, by saying that the grab-and-go meals are going to happen through Friday, September 11th, as we have school starting on Monday. But do you want to talk about a little bit about wrapping up the summer program, how that's gone? And
sure. Thanks for having me, guys. I appreciate it.
Our pleasure.
Always good to talk about food in the morning, right?
We're hungry. I just wanted to point that out.
Yeah. So wrapping up summer, it's been an unbelievable summer. This was supposed to be my first full school year at Westfield Public Schools as the food service director, and quite a curveball, but it has just shown me what an unbelievable staff I have and that we have here at Westfield Public Schools. All you guys from Stefan all the way down have just been unbelievable and amazing to work with. And, my staff has done unreal numbers just to round out this summer. At the end here, we're probably going to round out a little over 100,000 meals since the middle of March, with about 8 people producing at a time. So it's been pretty intense, but it just goes to show what the staff is capable of. And I just want to shout out to my staff and thank them for all their hard work.
Absolutely.
So do we.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And it's been, a nice little normalcy for the kids too, to be able to see some of their, cafeteria workers and managers out there serving the lunches, and I think that's been a really fun thing for my staff too, to be able to still see the kids come through, hand out stickers, hand out little things, and just get that moment with the children. So, wrapping up a summer program, like you said, we're going to do the grab and go meals like we have until the 11th. We'll switch gears. We're still going to be offering grab and go like we have been, but a little gear switch with schools opening. Now I'll be able to open all of my kitchens except, instead of just the two that we have currently. And so what that means is everybody in Westfield, because we just the other day, of course, like you said, curveball from the USDA, nothing like wait until the last minute. They gave us the expansion program until December 31st or when money runs out. So AKA that means whenever the money runs out, December 31st.
Or Congress passes another relief bill or some sort, but I think they're on break now. So
if everybody can urge your, you know, your governors and your senates and everybody to pass that bill for free universal meals, we really need it for the entire school year.
So we're free universal till the end of the year.
Correct. Yeah. Well, or till when the money runs out. Okay. So we're hoping that it runs till December 31st and that we can keep it as such. And then we might have to switch gears, you know, January 1st or when the money runs out. But
what would that look
point,
like during the school year?
You know, it's fantastic for Westfield because now until the end of the year, nobody has to worry about feeding their children breakfast and lunch. Even if you're a remote learner and you're at home and you're not going to be coming into the schools at all, you can still come daily to any school in the district and pick up meals starting when school starts on the 14th. The secondary schools are going to be pickups from 11 to 12. And then the elementary schools are going to be pickups from 11:30 to 12:30. We tried to sync it when they would have their remote learning breaks so that parents could step out, you know, with their child for a moment if they needed to and, you know, come and get the meals. And again, we're going to be giving breakfast and lunch all together at once so you don't have to come out twice during the day. And
Rachel,
we're hoping. Yep.
Sorry, could I ask for just a clarification for parents?
Sure.
We separate our district a lot into talking about pre-K to 6 and 7 to 12. So you said elementary is at
11:30 to 12:30.
And does that include the intermediate school, or is intermediate school included when the secondary pick up at 11?
So intermediate school will be included in the elementary zoning.
Okay.
We still classify the intermediate with their age group as elementary.
Right.
So secondary would be middle school and above.
Okay. Thank you.
High school. Sorry. So we're really excited to offer that. We are asking that people call in to whichever school because we know people have multiple kids across the district sometimes. So you pick whatever school is closest to you and easiest for you. And we're asking people just so that we don't overproduce and make a lot of food. If you can, please call the school you're going to pick up from the day ahead and let us know. And if you wanted to give a call and say, you know what, all of next week I'm going to pick up you know, for my four children, that gives us great numbers so that we don't waste and overproduce and things like that. So we're hoping people will call in. It'll be nice. We don't have to track anybody by student ID number or through our systems because it's all universal free. So the USDA made it really easy on us to serve meals to everybody that needs them. So I hope everybody can make it out.
And Rachel, do they call right into the manager's office at the school? Is that how they will notify?
The front office.
The front office. Okay.
Yeah. Unfortunately, with some of those kitchens and the managers, they keep to the phone in time. So I don't want to leave people hanging. So if you just call into the front office, you know, the secretary there will take your name. And again, we understand that things happen. So if you forget to call, please, you know, still come. We will make, you know, buffer meals, as we'll call it, so that we, just in case we run out, but just so that we're not overproducing and wasting in a time like this. We were hoping that people could give us some sort of idea if they will be coming. It would be super helpful.
So I'm going to be sending out a communication to families. And so if you have something you want me to send out along with that, please send it to me and I will get out to them. I know. And you know, and we have the district Facebook page, and I've been putting the flyers all summer so people know that we have, you know, because we keep extending the grab-and-go meals. At one point, they were done, what was it, August 21st, I think? Then we got another extension to the 31st. Then we got an extension to, I don't know, there were just so many extensions, which is great. But how many, I mean, I know at one point you were serving over 1,000 a day, right?
In March, you know, when we first, there was really a need for it. People were really scared. And we were at that point kind of making deliveries to certain points all around the city so that people didn't travel. And yeah, we were doing a little over 1,000 meals a day with probably four staff members at the time.
That's pretty incredible.
It is. It's unbelievable.
It was insane. In this summer, you know, we've made all the meals for the Boys and Girls Clubs and all of their sites. plus our own. So this summer was the busiest summer food service has ever seen in Westfield, for sure. But it was a blast. We were able to help a lot of families in need, and we were happy to do it.
And we want to continue to do that too. So that's what the message we want to get out.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Clearly breakfast and lunch are important. I'm telling to that to both of Susan and I too, because we seem to sometimes miss that piece. Skipping it. So, so you're launching a new Facebook page, right?
Yes, we are. Yeah. It's a great segue into that. I'm super excited about it. It's been a long time coming. I think, you know, food service has to have a presence out there in social media, and I'm really excited about it. It's going to be called Westfield Eats, and Eats is all in caps, and we'll be launching that either at the end of the day today or early tomorrow morning, nice. Just so that we can have another layer of communication with parents and children. And it'll be a fun place to do surveys if kids want to talk about what they like and don't like. You know, pictures of food for parents to see what we're actually serving, talking about the local farms that we use, because a lot of people.
That's fantastic. I don't think people know that. I want to know about that. Can you just talk about which farms we do work with? I think that's great.
Yeah. Like just for one example, you know, we do Mountain Orchards. So all of our nectarines in the beginning of the school year, our apples come from Mountain Orchards. They're great people. They do wonderful business and product. And they come out, they talk to the students, you know, well, pre-corona.
Right, yeah.
You know, and show them the equipment and how to pick apples and all the different types. And teach the kids that there's actually an apple that was made in Westfield. And forgive me, I don't remember the name, but a lot of fun facts for kids. And we do a lot of things like that, I think, that people don't know about in Westfield. So I'm excited to have the opportunity to, you know, shout things out on social media and catch some more people and let people know that it's not, you know, the mystery meats, you know, old school lunches as a
lunch lady land. Mountain Orchards is Granville, right? Mountain Orchards, Jensen family. I have a peach from there in my lunch today. Best peaches in the world come
nice.
From Granville, Massachusetts.
Yep.
Not Georgia?
No.
Not Georgia.
Second.
Nope.
So, I will tell you just from our Facebook page, we are, when we post something, we sometimes reach 5,000-6,000 people. And that's the way, you know, that's the way social media is the way of our world today. I have not created an Instagram account for our school district yet, but I've been told I need to do that because I guess people are using Instagram. I barely use Instagram. I really don't even know. I don't know if I get it.
No, so I have an account, but I don't use it.
What is that?
That's what the kids these days, they call it the gram.
The gram?
The
16-year-old had schooled me in that. And we will be opening an Instagram account, you know, to show photos of the food every day and some of the products we get in from the farms. So it's going to be really cool. I have an intern from UMass. She's actually a Westfield girl, born and raised, and she's a dietetic intern for UMass, and we're having a great time. She's teaching me a lot about social media, and in turn, I'm teaching her a lot about, you know, the directing food service in schools. So we're having a blast, and again, she's been just a wonderful help with the social media aspect.
If you get really slick with it, you can post something on Instagram and it cross-posts to Facebook automatically. Yep.
I've learned that as well. Yep, you can set it up where it does it automatically.
So one shot, double the bang for your buck.
Wow. And the kids don't really use Facebook. I'm hearing that. Is that accurate? I mean, are the kids
using Twitch and TikTok and things like
that? What the heck is TikTok?
It's a short video thing.
Yeah, it's videos and you can record yourself.
This is over my head. That's what I'm...
And that's what I'm learning. This UMass intern has really opened my eyes to the world of, I mean, she didn't even have a Facebook account. And I thought to myself, how could you not have one? But I guess Facebook is taking
passe.
A backseat.
It's for old people like us. That's what I was told.
The kids don't realize that Instagram is owned by Facebook. So,
Well. And I think Zuckerberg is probably one of the five top richest people in the world. Did
he
I
is,
see
yeah.
That right?
Elon's just passed him for number three.
He did. I saw that too.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so, Rachel, speaking of Elon, there was the show before us had a rocket launch.
That's all because of me, though. I kind of forced that on him.
That's okay, though. But we were told that we had to top a rocket launch. What do you got?
I
a good meal always tops a rocket launch.
Well, in my world, this does top a rocket launch. We actually just got approved for CEP standing for three of our elementary schools.
Okay. CEP, acronym. What does that mean?
So CEP is Community Eligibility Program. Okay. So that means that our three schools that meet the criteria deemed by the USDA and the state will now receive free breakfast and lunch for the next 4 years.
So every student gets that.
Right. Every student in these schools. So it's Abner Gibbs, Franklin Ave, and Paper Mill. So Melanie Chassie was just on, and that's her school. And these three schools have met the criteria, and we signed them up, got them validated, and super excited that we have that standing for the next 4 years. So those children and parents will not have to worry about breakfast and lunch at their schools and, dealing with the application portion of it or anything. So we're super excited about that. And it'll really enable us to serve a greater portion of those areas that really need it. So we're really happy about that and have it for the next 4 years. So,
and I think that's a great segue, because you talked about applications free and reduced. What are we doing with those this year because of the remote piece? Typically, I know students get them right at the beginning of the school year, right? So if they're remote, how are we doing that this year?
Yeah, so we had to switch gears, like with everything else, and we decided to take that on ourselves. So myself and some of the staff and the secretary here have been painstakingly folding and stuffing envelopes for the past week. So we're going to send those out by mail to every household, because unfortunately, we don't have the start of school and backpacks to help us.
Right.
But to still go out, even with this standing of free universal meals until December. Once December is up, and if they don't extend it, if they can't because of the money running out, then we would revert back to a normal school year where we have to go by people's statuses, if they're paid, free, reduced. So that's why we're still going through this process. We're still urging everybody, especially now, while people are unemployed, while things are happening, to fill out the applications, because once you fill it out, you get that free, if you qualify, you get the free or reduced standing for the entire school year, plus the first 30 days of next school year. So in January, if this all runs out,
we're going to need that.
Right. And you have your job back, and you're doing okay trying to catch up. Then you've missed the boat. So we're really urging everybody now.
Do it at the beginning of the year.
Do it at the beginning of the year. And again, you can do it any time during the year. So if anybody comes on hard times, loses a job, takes in more people into their household, that makes a huge difference. Not just income, but it goes by how many people live in your household.
Right.
All of those factors matter, and you can fill it out at any time. Hopefully by October, the end of October, beginning of November, we'll have the application available online with an online system where you can fill it out online. We're just waiting for that to come through, for our program. But we're really hopeful that everybody fills it out, gets it in, and then have your status, so that when January comes, if we have to revert back, everybody is, all filled out and ready to go for the school year. So you'll be receiving those in the mail. And of course, I'll slip little flyers in there about food service and things like my school bucks.
Segue. So, and that's new too. I mean, we started last year, but we didn't have that before. So we're starting to see the food services department move forward under your leadership. So thank you. I mean, what is my school bucks for someone who may not have an idea? Do we do with it?
Trying to get food services here and into the 21st century and making it easier on parents. we signed up for My School Bucks. So myschoolbucks.com is an online portal that links up with our schools and our system. So you can sign on. You never have to make any payments through the system or use the payment system, but still make an account for yourself and your children, in the district. Even if you have multiple schools, in the district that, your kids are in, you can make one account and you can see everything your kids are purchasing, the money that they have left in the account. You can set it up automatic payments so that when the child gets down to $5, it automatically puts $20. So you're never in the red. I do it myself. I have four children, and it makes it very easy to go on and kind of set that up automatically, so I don't even have to think about it for the school year. And I get to check and see what they're actually eating, which is
why'd nice. You get 30 cookies yesterday? That's what I'm saying. All right, Rachel, listen, we have to wrap up. I'm sorry. Pete's giving me the signal. Oh, no. Our next show is coming. Any final thought? And I want to thank you for being on the show.
No, thank you so much. And just if anybody has any questions, concerns, or really needs help with anything, please call into the food service office. You know, we're always here to help.
And what's your number, just to remind them?
413-572-6493.
All right. Thank you again for joining us, Rachel. We'll see you soon.
Bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
All right, folks, thanks for listening to our show today. Susan, thanks for co-hosting. That was the fastest hour. I feels like we just sat down.
Flew by.
But we do have to go. Pete, thanks again for all your assistance. Folks, next week we're going to talk with Susan Dargy and Erica Mascadrelli and the supervisors. So we're going to have about curriculum and what all kinds of great stuff about remote learning. So tune in next week. Thank you, everyone.